I'm Darius Spearman, and you're watching African Elements. In this video, I'll explore the dynamics that shaped slave life on the plantations of the Deep South. As slavery was trending toward increasingly heavy reliance on the cotton plantations of the Deep South, we'll look at a first-hand account describing daily life on those plantations and the culture that was forged from it. All that coming up next. Thank you for watching African Elements. If you're new to this channel, we create classroom content in Black and Africana studies and give it to the people. I believe education should be free, but if you'd like to support us and gain access to additional materials, check out our Patreon page at the link in the description. There you can find access to ad-free videos and other materials for as little as a dollar a month. In this video, we discuss the dynamics that shaped the life and culture of enslaved Blacks on the plantations of the Deep South. Would you survive? Between 1790 and 1860, the slave population of the United States grew from about 700,000 to about 4 million. There were a variety of settings, each of which created a different set of cultural survival strategies. That's the reason why Black culture manifests differently in Mobile, Alabama, as opposed to, say, Charleston, South Carolina. Agricultural laborers constituted 75% of the South's slave population. About 55% of slaves cultivated cotton, 10% grew tobacco, and 10% produced sugar, rice, or hemp. About 15% were domestic servants, and the remaining 10% worked in trades. There's a common misconception that by the time of the Civil War, slavery was a dying institution. As far back as record-keeping goes, though, the slave population climbed steadily from the 1600s through 1860, and at no point was the 10-year growth rate less than 20%. There was, however, a decline in slave owners. As I noted in my book, Between the Color Lines, The History of African Americans on the California Frontier through 1890, from 1830 to 1860, the percentage of Southern whites who owned slaves dropped dramatically from 36% to 4.7%. Even when adding the members of the registered slaveholders' immediate family, fully three-fourths of the Southern white population neither owned slaves nor claimed any significant share of the windfall profits generated by the institution of slavery. Out of less than 5% of Southern whites who owned slaves, only 12% owned more than 20, and just 1% owned more than 50 slaves. Yet more than half of the slaves belonged to slave owners with 20 or more slaves. So, although the typical slave owner owned few slaves, the typical slave lived on a sizable plantation. Cotton was by far the most important staple crop in the South and the country as a whole. By 1860, cotton exports amounted to more than 50% of the dollar value of all U.S. exports. So, although there are other settings that I'll focus on in later videos, the cotton industry and the culture of slave resistance that rose from it is going to be the focus of this video. One of the best first-hand accounts of life in the Cotton Kingdom is a memoir of Solomon Northrop, published in 1853. In it, he describes the horrific experience of a typical day in the life of a slave on a Louisiana cotton plantation. Kidnapped and sold into slavery in 1841, Northrop was held in slavery for 12 years in the Red River region of Louisiana. Northrop's memoir gives an eyewitness account of the brutality that accompanied everyday slave life on southern plantations. He writes, "In the latter part of August begins the cotton picking season. The hands are required to be in the cotton field as soon as it is light in the morning, and with the exception of 10 or 15 minutes at noon, they're not permitted to be a moment idle until it's too dark to see, and when the moon is full, they oftentimes labor till the middle of the night. An ordinary day's work is 200 pounds. The day's work over in the field, the cotton is weighed. No matter how fatigued and weary he may be, no matter how much he longs for sleep and rest, a slave never approaches the gin house but with fear. If it falls short in weight, he knows that he must suffer. And if he exceeds it by 10 or 20 pounds, in all probability, his master will measure the next day's task accordingly. So, whether he has too little or too much, his approach to the gin house is always with fear and trembling. After weighing, follow the whippings. This done, the labor of the day is not yet ended by any means. Each one must then attend to his respective chores. Finally, at a late hour, they reach the quarters sleepy and overcome with the long day's toil. Then, a fire must be kindled in the cabin, and supper and dinner for the next day in the field prepared. The same fear of punishment with which they approach the gin house possesses them again on lying down to get a snatch of rest. It is the fear of oversleeping in the morning. Such an offense would certainly be attended with not less than 20 lashes. An hour before daylight, the horn is blown. Then the slaves arouse, prepare their breakfast, and hurry to the field again. Then the fears and labors of another day begin. And until close, there is no such thing as rest. He fears he'll be caught lagging through the day. He fears to approach the gin house with his basket load of cotton at night. He fears when he lies down that he will oversleep himself in the morning. Such is a true, faithful, unexaggerated picture and description of the slave's daily life during the time of cotton picking on the shores of Bayou Buff. Enslaved blacks had to acquire the skills needed to protect themselves and their loved ones from a brutal slave system. As mentioned earlier, in the decades before the Civil War, slavery was becoming increasingly monopolistic. Since the closing of the international slave trade in 1808, many small-scale slave owners, the nearly 90% of those who owned less than 20 slaves, found it more profitable to sell individuals down the river to feed the growing demand for slave labor on the plantations. As a result of the domestic slave trade between 1830 and 1860, an estimated 50% of the slaves from the Upper South were trafficked to the plantations of the Deep South. In the Upper South, enslaved black brothers, sisters, husbands, and wives lived with a constant fear of separation from their families. As a cultural adaptation, black families relied heavily on the extended family and even fictive kin as a hedge against the family disruption that the domestic slave trade inflicted. Parents and older relatives taught slave children how to avoid punishment while still resisting the masters and overseers. Folk tales often derived from Africa told lessons imparted by animal tricksters. Most famously, a series of tales tell the story of how Br'er Rabbit outsmarts his brethren, Br'er Fox and Br'er Bear. The stories taught slave children critical life lessons on the value of avoiding trouble by using their wits and remaining calm to cleverly escape punishment. They learned to watch what they said to white people, not to talk back, to withhold information about other blacks, and to dissemble. In particular, they refrained from making anti-slavery statements and camouflaged their awareness of how masters exploited them. Other strategies included feigning illness, accidentally breaking tools and injuring mules, oxen, and horses to tacitly protest their condition. Many slave owners during the 19th century sponsored plantation churches for slaves, but enslaved blacks preferred a semi-secret church that they conducted themselves under the leadership of self-called, often illiterate black preachers. They emphasized Moses and deliverance from bondage rather than the theology of Christian meekness. Under the guise of religion, enslaved blacks not only learned to communicate through coded language, but in their spirituals, they developed strategies to slow the work pace so that it was just fast enough to avoid the lash, and no faster. As we've seen, by the eve of the Civil War, slavery was far from a dying institution. On the contrary, the population of enslaved blacks increased steadily, even as the number of slave owners decreased. Slavery was trending more heavily toward a monopolistic plantation-based institution, with cotton as its mainstay. It was maintained by brute force and terror, but it also forged a culture of resiliency and ingenuity. How do you see that culture manifesting today? Let's hear your thoughts in the comments below. I'm Darius Spearman. Thank you for watching, and be sure to hit that like and subscribe button if you found this material worthwhile. And until next time, I'll see you in the comments.